everyone, and welcome to CEC Gurukul Live Lectures. Today, the topic that we will be learning together is International Trade System. I am Dr. Amna. I teach political science at the Shyama Prasad Mukherjee College for Women, University of Delhi. The learning today is divided over few phases. In few parts, we'll be looking at first, we will try to understand what is trade per se as a mechanism, as a process, and its ramifications for the international milieu. Followed by that, we'll be looking at various theories of trade that will give us insights into the dimensions of the political, economic aspects which are at play while we discuss and analyze international trade. And after that, we'll be looking at the institutional apparatus that is under play in the milieu, in the scenario of international relations, looking at the challenges and opportunities, and also having a discussion on globalization, that whether international trade system, which has been fueled and propelled by globalization, was it an equal mechanism for all? As we begin our learning, let us understand trade. See, trade signifies exchanging goods and services between two people or entity. When we look at international trade, it is about exchange between people or entities in two different countries. Now, the inherent assumption of trade is that there is a belief of benefit from the exchange. Now, trade has been carried out in monetary as well as non-monetary aspect. The non-monetary aspect of trade was seen in the barter system, and the monetary aspect of trade is seen when goods and services are exchanged for a price. After this understanding of international trade as an exchange between people or entities in different countries, we now look into trade theories. See, international trade theories are simply different theories to explain the mechanisms, the processes, the trade-off, the factors responsible, the factors at work to explain international trade. Around 5,200 years ago, Uruk in southern Mesopotamia, probably the first time the world saw housing, agriculture, irrigation canals, and trade intermediaries. And this is what gives a reflection as to what can really guide people to trade, because there is a belief that exchange helps, exchange paves way for betterment. This idea of Uruk being in southern Mesopotamia and the idea of civilization, we can read more about it from Matt Ridley, Humans, Why They Triumph, Wall Street Journal. So, when we try to look at the historical trajectory of trade, Thomas Friedman's work really comes to great help here. Thomas Friedman's world, that is flat world approach, it divides history, it tries to segment history into three stages. Let us have a look at them. Globalization 1.0, from 1492 to 1800, where nations dominated global expansion. Globalization 2.0, from 1800 to 2000, where multinational companies ascended and pushed global development. Followed by that, globalization 3.0, that is 2000 to the present, wherein technology is driving out the factors that are driving globalization. It is technology that is paving way for this age that we define as age of disruption. At the start, it is very important to understand how countries traded with one another historically, and this dimension of various segments of history, that is globalization 1.0, primarily we saw nations dominating global expansion, maybe in the form of imperial expansion. Globalization 2.0, where we saw new non-state actors coming into realm, and globalization 3.0, where technology and developments in transport and communication are responsible for driving the interlinkages between and among nations and people. And then followed by that, the very idea of globalization 4.0, where in today's time, we are talking about the idea of rollback of globalization, and thereby once again, international trade becomes an important factor of analysis. This brings us to the various assumptions, the various ideas that explain international trade. Now, at the very outset, the classical theory or the country-based theories, mercantilism developed in the 16th century. And in this theory, in this idea, was that country's wealth was determined by the amount of its gold and silver holdings. Countries should increase its holdings of gold and silver by promoting exports and discouraging imports. In the same vein, there was the idea of trade surplus, where the value of exports were greater than the value of imports. Then we have in this trade bargain, that is, an attempt was made to avoid trade deficit. By trade deficit, it was implied that a situation where the value of imports is greater than the value of exports. Followed by that, in roughly around 1500s, the world saw the rise of nation states. Nation states had armies, national institutions. They wanted to secure national interests further by this establishment factor. And one of the ways that many of these new nations promoted exports was to impose restrictions on imports. Now, this brings us to the another idea that comes with mercantilism. Mercantilism, as we all know, it is one of the oldest trade theories. That was the idea, corollary to that was protectionism, that is promoting exports, that was to impose restrictions on imports. Now, at this hour, we have to take into account that countries like, if you look at specific case studies like Japan, China, Singapore, Taiwan, some of their trade practices still favor exports and discourage imports. Quite often, it is looked upon as, in the present time, as neo-mercantilism, that is protectionist policies and restrictions, and thereby giving more favor to domestic industry via subsidies. Now, when we try to discuss international trade, an important theory that gives us a basic idea as to why countries indulge in trade within and amongst each other is that of absolute advantage. In 1776, Adam Smith questioned the mercantilist theory. Adam Smith's most important work that we must always refer while we're trying to understand international trade, The Wealth of Nations by Adam Smith, an inquiry into the nature and causes of wealth of nations. It was published in 1776, and herein there was this new trade theory that was propelled as opposed to the mercantilist theory that was absolute advantage. What do we imply by absolute advantage? Ability of a country to produce a good more efficiently than another nation. Trade between countries, therefore, the idea was, should be on a paradigm of laissez-faire. Trade between countries should not be regulated. Trade should flow naturally. For example, if a country A could produce a good cheaper or faster or both than a specific country B, in such a scenario, country A has the advantage and could focus on specializing on producing that good. Now, the advantages of the absolute advantage theory was, it gave way to specialization. It propelled the need to generate efficiencies. Labor force in such a scenario would become more skilled. Also, production would become more efficient. Another theory of international trade was that of comparative advantage. David Ricardo, an English economist, introduced the theory of comparative advantage in 1817. And this theory held that even if country A had the absolute advantage in the production of both products, specialization and trade could still occur between the two countries. Therefore, comparative advantage focuses on the relative productivity differences, whereas the absolute advantage looks at the absolute productivity aspect. So therefore, it gives a scenario that is, nations could be doing what they relatively do better. It gives another insight that world economy is more complex. It presents to us that there are various barriers also that are involved in trade. And most important, trade is a very complex enterprise between two or more countries. And at the same time, while we are discussing trade, one cannot ignore the other aspects involved in trade, like goods have to be transported, goods have to be distributed, amongst others. Another theory of trade was Heckscher-Ohlin theory, which we often call as the factor proportions theory. It was presented early in the 1900s, wherein two Swedish economists, Eli Heckscher and Bertil Ohlin, focused their attention on how a country could gain comparative advantage by producing goods that utilize factors that were in abundance in the country. Now, this theory is based on a country's production factors, namely land, labor, capital. This theory also gives us an insight as to how cost of any factor or resource was a function of supply and demand. The factors that were in great supply relative to demand would be cheaper. Factor in great demand relative to supply would be more expensive. Let's take an example here. For example, country A, a particular country A has cheap large pools of labor. Therefore, it becomes the optimal location for labor intensive industries, for example, textiles and garments. Another theory was the Leontief paradox, that is, in the early 1950s, Russian-born American economist Leontief studied the US economy closely and noted that United States was abundant in capital and therefore should export more capital intensive goods. However, his research using actual data showed the opposite, that United States was importing more capital intensive goods, reverse of what was that expected by the factor proportions theory. So this theory also gives us the insight that international trade is complex. It is impacted by numerous and factors that are often changing. And then one also must keep in account that trade as a phenomena, as a process, cannot be just explained by one single theory. Then there are modern or firm-based theories, which are a contrast to the classical country-based theories. They emerged roughly around the end of Second World War. And in that period, the contextual driving force was the growth of multinational organizations, multinational companies. Trade between two countries of goods produced in the same industry. For example, Japan exports Toyota vehicles to Germany and imports Mercedes-Benz automobiles from Germany. So therefore, there was factor or focus on brand, customer loyalty, technological innovations, qualitative aspects into the understanding of trade flows. And often, when we say this gives us an insight into the aspects of firms and industries involved in the international trade flow milieu. With this, we come to another dimension, that is country similarity theory. So the Swedish economist Stefan Linder developed the country similarity theory in 1961. Consumers in countries that are in the same or similar stage of development would have similar preferences. This theory is often most useful in understanding trade in goods where brand names, product reputations are important factors in buyers' decision making and purchasing processes. Then we have product life cycle theory. Herein, Raymond Vernon, Harvard Business School professor, who developed the product life cycle theory in 1960s. Now here what we need to take into account is that product life cycle has three different stages: new product, maturing product, and standardized products. The theory assumed that production of the new product will occur completely in the home country of its innovation. Then we have global strategic rivalry theory, which emerged recently in 1980s, which is based on the work of economists Paul Krugman and Kelvin Lancaster. Their theory focused on multinational corporations, their efforts to gain a competitive advantage against the global firms in their industry, and the critical ways that firm can obtain a sustainable competitive advantage are called the barriers to entry for that industry. Once this understanding now passes understanding of various theories, ideas that are involved as to what drives international trade, we now look at certain actual practices that have gone in the paradigm of international trade, and we will now have a look at the contemporary scenario, that is the period after the First World War roughly, or Second World War broadly. Creation of GATT was one of the landmark aspects in the international trade regime. Now the journey of GATT started in 1948 in Havana, the place in Cuba. Followed by that, there was Annecy Round in France, Torquay Round, United Kingdom, Tokyo Round, Japan, Punta del Este Round, Uruguay. Now, with all these rounds, time and again, there was increase in membership as well as issues which GATT dealt with. So, therefore, when we look at the time framework from 1948 to 1994, GATT therefore provided rules for world trade. It was a provisional agreement and a ad hoc organization that paved way for a larger multilateral trading agreement. aim of GATT was to create an institution to handle trade side of international economic cooperation, joining the Bretton Woods institutions, namely the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund. What one saw was, after the end of the Second World War, over 50 countries participated in negotiations to create an international trade organization, which is a specialized agency of the United Nations too. The aim of GATT, therefore, was to that international trade, the need for it to be regulated, and that international trade was regulating the contracting parties to achieve the purpose of the agreement, which were reducing tariffs and other barriers, and to achieve liberalization in international trade. However, as GATT's rounds were going on and there was establishment of international trade organization, there was a setback, and the setback was United States did not take a leadership role in global trade policy making until the Great Depression. And what happened was that we have to look at the domestic scenario here. In the United States Constitution, the Congress has the responsibility for promoting and regulating commerce. The executive branch has the responsibility for foreign policy, and the trade policy, therefore, becomes an arena of tug of war between the two branches of the government. In 1934, the United States marked the Reciprocal Trade Agreement Act of 1934. Now, what happens here was that in order to expand and increase employment, the United States Congress agreed to permit the executive branch to negotiate bilateral trade agreements. But with the Second World War, and after the end of the Second World War, with general agreement on tariffs and trade, with the establishment of International Trade Organization, one saw a different perspective coming forward from the US side. GATT was simply a temporary multilateral agreement designed to provide a framework of rules and a forum to negotiate trade barrier reductions amongst countries. It was built on the Reciprocal Trade Agreements Act, which allowed the executive branch in the United States to negotiate trade agreements with temporary authority from the Congress. The ITO, which was set up as a court for world trade principles and to factor in issues for to facilitate world trade, and to later work out a formal international institution. ITO was influenced by the ideas of John Maynard Keynes, the British economist, who always upheld the idea that internationalization, with the view that governments could play a positive role in encouraging international economic growth. But what happened was that the final charter was signed by 54 nations at the UN Conference on Trade and Employment at Havana in March 1948. The ITO could not have the support for internationalism that was accompanied after the end of the Second World War, and which also this same internationalism led to the establishment of agencies such as the United Nations, the IMF, the World Bank. At this hour, again very significant to point out that the United States Congress never brought membership in the International Trade Organization to a vote, and thereby not seeking ratification of the Havana Charter. This brings us to other dimensions of GATT, that GATT was not a treaty. The United States and other nations joined GATT under its Protocol of Provisional Applications. Provisions of GATT were binding as they were not inconsistent with, as long as they were not inconsistent with the nation's existing legislation. Then, of course, the world saw that there was increase in trade liberalization and Further, they were contravening the rules of GATT when politically or economically necessary, as one can see from the reports of US Tariff Commission also 1950. So therefore, from 1948 to 1993 roughly, GATT's purview and membership grew dramatically. 8 trade rounds were conducted where member nations called contracting parties. They agreed to mutually reduce trade barriers also. The establishment of the World Trade Organization was because a growing number of nations decided that GATT could serve better for global trade expansion if it becomes a formal international organization. In 1988, the US Congress, in the Omnibus Trade and Competitive Act, explicitly called for more effective dispute settlement mechanisms. They pressed for negotiations to formalize GATT and to make it a more powerful and comprehensive organization. The result was that World Trade Organization, which was established during the Uruguay round 1986 to 1993 of GATT negotiations, and which subsumed later the GATT. This WTO, World Trade Organization, now provides a permanent arena for member governments to address international trade issues. It oversees the implementation of the trade agreements negotiated in the Uruguay round of trade talks. Now, then it is important here now to differentiate between WTO and GATT. WTO is not simply a forum. It is beyond. It is not simply GATT transformed into a formal international mechanism or organization. It covers a much broader purview, including subsidies, services, intellectual property, food safety, amongst others. Further, WTO has strong dispute settlement mechanism. As under GATT, panels weigh trade disputes, but however, these panels have to adhere to a strict time schedule for WTO. Moreover, in contrast with GATT procedure, no country can veto or delay the panel decisions of WTO. The structure of WTO, we have to look at that. The structure of WTO is dominated by the highest authority, Ministerial Conference. This is composed of representatives of all WTO members, which is required to meet at least every 2 years, and which can take decision on all matters under any of the multilateral trade agreements. The General Council is composed of representatives of all the members. Therefore, the key components of World Trade Organization are, number one, executive apparatus, legislative apparatus, and an enforcement apparatus. And it is this structure that distinguishes WTO very clearly from its predecessor, that was GATT. The functions of WTO, once we try to understand, we go to the authentic online aspects provided to us by WTO, that is WTO.org, and we try to read it from there. The functions of WTO are administering WTO trade agreements, providing a forum for trade negotiation, handling trade disputes, monitoring national trade policies, providing technical assistance and training for developing countries, ensuring cooperation with other international organizations. Now, once we try to understand WTO and look at the history of GATT, there's one important term that we must take into account: plurilateral agreement. Plurilateral agreement signifies that member countries would be given the choice to agree to new rules on a voluntary basis. This contrasts with the multilateral WTO agreement, where all members are party to the agreement. The difference, therefore, is Multilateral negotiations are those negotiations involving all World Trade Organization contracting parties. The plurilateral trade agreements involve several countries with a common interest but do not involve all WTO countries. Now, once we are trying to understand international trade system from the preview of international political economy and global affairs thereof, one very important term that we must understand is new protectionism, wherein government enters the economy to protect the local industry, the local people from the effects or popular effects of an economically uncertain future. This is happening right now in the world scenario. The primarily objective of trade protectionism is to protect a nation's vital economic interests, such as key industries, commodities, employment of workers, amongst others. Protectionism, therefore, is a policy of protecting domestic industries against foreign competition by means of tariffs, subsidies, import quotas, or other restrictions or handicaps placed on the imports of foreign competitors. We have to ask at this hour and debate at this hour why protectionism may be harmful, because any action is not has its pros and cons. Similarly, when a government is trying to shield its domestic industry, this may lead to a situation for more corruption and nepotism, thereby working on barriers to enable to let your homegrown company to have more change, to have more access for the better. Now, let's understand what are the types of protectionist measures that can go in by a nation in order to shield its trade. First, tariff. That is, what are tariffs? They are taxes on imports, which can either be specific, that is, so much per unit of sales, or ad valorem, a percentage of the price of the product. Then quotas, exchange controls, export subsidies, or voluntary export restraints. These are some of the ways by which protectionist measures can be heralded by any nation state. Now, this brings us to another important dimension for international trade, that was globalization. Globalization has always existed. Globalization can be seen from the idea of interchange and exchange of ideas, and this was prevalent right from the Silk Road. However, in the contemporary times, globalization driven by neoliberal capitalist forces saw that with this interchange and exchange of ideas, goods, services, people, with the globalization being defined with words like internationalization, westernization, Americanization, one saw that people did benefit. However, there were tremendous challenges that remain. If there was free flow of goods and services, then at the other side, there was this debate, is this trade leading to more divisions between the rich and the poor countries? If there was rampant rise of trade-driven globalization, then at the other side, there was this debate, are rich countries exploiting the resources of the poor countries? And largely, there was this issue that are certain countries at the receiving end because of rampant growth paradigm of few rich countries. In this scenario, United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, UNCTAD, that we say, it is a permanent intergovernmental body established by United Nations General Assembly in 1964. Its headquarters are located in Geneva. The United Nations Trade Conference on Trade and Development, UNCTAD, is essential for us to see that how within globalization, within international relations and within international trade, there were voices to streamline the wrongdoings or the drawbacks of any trade mechanism, and UNCTAD is primarily one of them. Its mandate is to support developing countries to access the benefits of a globalized economy more fairly and effectively. It attempts to equip them to deal with potential drawbacks of greater economic integration and facilitate consensus building and offer technical assistance. Now, this idea of UNCTAD's work and mandate is assuming that trade, investment, finance, and technology are vehicles for inclusive and sustainable development. It tries to comprehend options to address macro level development challenges. It tries to achieve beneficial integration into international trading system, and then it tries to diversify economies to make them less dependent on commodities. All of it are also showing us the complexities that are involved in any international trade aspect and international trade mechanism. As we read out more from the mandate about UNCTAD from their authentic website sources, UNCTAD.org, we read that the UNCTAD tries to limit the exposure of developing countries to financial volatility and debt. It tries to attract investment and make it more development friendly. It attempts to increase the access to digital technologies. It tries to promote entrepreneurship and innovation. So therefore, when we look at international trade, from financial volatility to digitalization to innovation to entrepreneurship, all of it are important factors. There are variables that are constantly changing that one must look into and debate into while trying to understand how the apparatus of international trade moves as a mechanism within international political economy. Then, while we are trying to understand international trade, we also have to see that there were alternative voices also. The Group of 77, was established on 15 June 1964 by 77 developing countries, signatories of the Joint Declaration of the 77 developing countries, issued at the end of the first session of United Nations Conference on Trade and Development. The G77 at the United Nations, therefore, is a coalition of developing nations designed to promote members' collective economic interests. And trade is definitely one of the primary economic interests for any nation, and thereby create an enhanced joint negotiating capacity in the United Nations. Once we read out more about the mandate for G77, once again we take recourse to the authentic website sources, www.g77.org. The G77 is a means for the countries of the South to articulate and promote their collective economic interests and enhance their joint negotiating capacity on all major international economic issues within United Nations system and promote South-South cooperation for development. Then let's have a look at certain facts that are essential for us to comprehend the directions that are involved, or to give us an idea as to the contours that are in present international trade realm. So we take the data from WTO.org. The WTO economists expect merchandise trade volume growth to fall in to say 2.6% in 2019, down from 3.0% in 2018. The trade growth could then be rebound to 3% in 2020. However, this is this is dependent on an easing of trade tensions. this brings us, you know, this data makes us to the next aspect, that is the issues that are there significant for nations to look into while dealing with international trade. Some of them are distance, diversity, transport and communication, risk and uncertainty, lack of information, import and export restrictions. These are essential for us to factor in, because no trade can go unless and until a nation looks at the aspects of distance, diversity, transports, risks, innovations, technological changes, and various the aspects of policy making for import and export that a nation is following, because these are the aspects of interface as well as barriers for any nation to dwell further for international trade. Now, in the present scenario, once if we look at that, there is a debate on renegotiation, withdrawal from North American Free Trade Agreement. There are news about opposition through Trans-Pacific Partnership. Then there are debates about the need to give primacy to economic nationalism. Then there is a debate on threat of punitive action on part of certain nation states, and thereby the risk escalating conflict that may emerge for the larger international trade regime. In such a scenario, it is pertinent to ask, has globalization done more bad than good? Now, at this hour, we will take the ideas of late Deen Dayal Upadhyay ji's, that is, you know, economics, once we look at it from a different perspective, it has a means for promoting welfare of human beings. Now, this is also based on Kautilya's Arthashastra, and even late Deen Dayal Upadhyay ji gave us this idea that economic activity, therefore, is a means for developing the faculties and skills of human beings. The rampant economic process that only gives primacy to profit, that only gives primacy to acquiring more and more wealth, definitely is at loggerheads with this larger idea of economics for the need to provide welfare of human beings, for the need to develop the faculties and skills of human beings. The idea of Swadeshi, that is the need for a larger framework of analysis for economic reconstruction of society. One must read the views of Professor Ashwani Mahajan also here in order to understand, to safeguard national interests with respect to the need to balance forces of economic activity with decentralization and placing Swadeshi as a guiding idea for economic reconstruction of the country. At this hour, when we are trying to reach Swadeshi, let's read more from Mahatma Gandhi's ideas, that is, it's a movement which restricts one to serve the neighboring countries while using their products. In the economic realm, Swadeshi encourages, therefore, domestic production and boycott of the foreign. Lastly, we come to a very important work by Joseph Stiglitz in the year 2002. This work came forward, and the book was Globalization and Its Discontents. Now, in this book, we get the idea for the need to reform the process or globalization. Stiglitz's main argument is that the original mission of IMF was of ensuring global economic stability. But sadly, what comes out that IMF abandoned its role, its missions, and today IMF is driven by, instead, as though its mission was to advance rampant financial deregulation and to be the beacon for interests of financial capital. In this work by Stiglitz, Globalization and Its Discontents, we can get examples like IMF policies, where an East Asian financial crisis, the Argentinian economic crisis, how all of it the role of IMF was questionable. He also lays the blame at IMF's door for Russian failed attempt to convert to a market economy, as well as the lack of development in sub-Saharan Africa. So therefore, this tells us, like, once we're looking at Stiglitz's idea of globalization and its discontent, and then we are looking at the idea of the need to get back to Swadeshi, how globalization therefore did more bad than good. And there's a debate going on here, that is, should globalization be called back, or should we move towards a new version of world apparatus, new ideas in international political economy, where we must think about the need to rethink on economy as a need to promote and to place human welfare, human faculties and skills, decentralization, grassroots voices at the main focus of analysis while dealing with international trade system and issues of global economy thereof. Therefore, when we are looking at renegotiation of NAFTA, opposition to TPP, and the need to give primacy to economic nationalism, the debate is on as to what could be an appropriate perspective, the right approach to deal and lead the nations for economic aspects, economic gains, and international trade thereof. Therefore, the issues of international trade, be it be diversity, be it be changes in transport and communication, be it be risk, rising uncertainty, these issues are always changing. And because of changes in these issues, because of lack of constancy, or we can say high degree of variability in these issues, international trade as an issue for international political economy and global affairs therefore demands constant vigilance, demands constant analysis and research as to what are the factors going on at a particular time for a particular nation in its trade negotiations and its trade deals. The international milieu has seen that right from creation of GATT to establishment of WTO, two new forums like UNCTAD, G77, today, trade is being debated at a very holistic, comprehensive level. And these trade debates give us an insight into the dynamic nature of not only international trade, but dynamic nature for global affairs and also for international political economy thereof. No doubt, trade, that is an exchange between nations, is always involving lots of questions, and theories are there to think, make us think as to what actually goes for a nation to strike the deal for its trade negotiation. But however, these theories, as we just saw, from mercantilist to classical to comparative advantage to the product theory to market-based theory, all these theories, they try and present their explanation, their perspective in their idea of what actually defines and what actually goes in to making of a trade deal. It is very essential to understand that how, when we look at absolute advantage perspective, it tries to make us pave way for specialization and generating efficiency. When we look at David Ricardo's comparative advantage, how it tries to make us focus on the relative productivity differences. And then when we try to look at the proportions, factor proportions theory, it tries to give us that how cost of any factor or resource becomes a function of demand and supply. And then when we try to look at other theories like firm-based or modern firm-based theories, we get an idea that how international trade is complex, it is impacted by numerous and often changing factors, and therefore trade cannot just be explained by one factor. Once we understand these various perspectives on trade, the historical evolution of trade, that is primarily from the post-Second World War period, shows that trade has gradually evolved. It did not happen over time. Trade talks responded to the needs of the time. We saw that right from start in 1948 to Annecy, Torquay, Tokay, Punta del Este, Montreal rounds. Today, GATT, from being a forum to ensure rules for world trade, has converted itself to a forum for multilateral trade agreements. ITO, of course, had a rough start with United States not giving it the right ratification, yet the trade talks went on. There was increase in membership, there was increase in countries being a part of these trades with every trade round. And amidst all these ups and downs, GATT, which was simply a temporary multilateral agreement, with time translated itself into a WTO, which is just beyond a treaty and has a specific mandate, an elaborate mandate to deal with trade issues. It provides a permanent arena for member governments to address international trade issues. It's a forum for negotiation. It's a forum for trade facilitation. And with all this, it is essential to see that how the dynamics of international trade, once they pave way from GATT to a WTO, that WTO, therefore, because of these dynamics and complexities, was a much broader review, much concise in its mandate, and it was not just a agreement, but it was formalized as a treaty. Now, once we look at the complexities of the decision making, dispute resolution, the key structures of WTO, very essential to see that how today WTO is handling complex trade issues, monitoring trade policies, amongst others. And the agreements, from being plurilateral trade agreements, have moved themselves to a level of multilateral negotiations, where the agreements are now binding on the partners, and thereby it requires changes in their domestic law of the land also. Within all this, there is an alternative countercurrent of protectionism, where through quotas, tariffs, subsidies, countries do try to protect their domestic economy. And this debate between globalization and the rollback of globalization, one can witness in these trade-offs between tariffs and quotas. International trade regime, just like any regime, had its own pros and cons, had its own contested realms too. And when we look at UNCTAD and the activities and initiatives of G77, the call for new international economic order, one sees that there was a mechanism play also in working in order to put forward the voices of the South, in order to work out avenues to factor in collective economic interests also. So therefore, this lecture today was about dynamics of international trade. International trade is one of the main pillars for international political economy. Therefore, changes in international trade are bound to impact the working, the debate, and the issues that are at stake for international political economy and global relations thereof. Like any phenomena, international trade too has its own ups and downs, owing to its complexity, owing to various degrees of issues at stake involved in international trade negotiations. So, dear listeners, do write to us. You have our email address. We look forward to your queries. We look forward to sort them out. And we look forward to present more lectures, more insights to you for various topics. So do share your positive, encouraging feedback at our email address. Thank you very much for this learning session. We hope you all enjoyed this session, and we look forward to your encouraging feedback and queries that you may have. Thank you.